Good evening, and welcome to our keynote for this evening. My name is Dan Hassler-Forrest. I am a science fiction scholar, but for tonight, I'm just going to be the moderator for this event, which I'm super excited to do, not just because it's really lovely to be in an audience with actual people. Not to disparage the people who are watching this online, because this is a hybrid event, and we're going to have, so hello to everybody watching this via IMPAKT TV. But it's kind of special to be, you know, at a festival that is a physical festival as well. I struggle to find a way to introduce Srećko Horvat's work to you without descending into immediate hyperbole, which makes him super uncomfortable, so I'm definitely going to do it. Srećko, for those of you who don't know him, he's a Croatian philosopher, I think is the shortest way to describe him, but he is a philosopher in the best and most meaningful sense of the word, one of the thinkers, I think one of the great thinkers for our age, who is erudite, literate, you know, and like scary smart. But I also kind of hesitate to describe him as a philosopher, because I think when we think of philosopher, we think of people who are just sort of, you know, in the world of thought and theory and kind of removed from practice. And that's totally the wrong way to describe what Srećko does, because what he does is he takes theory, he takes philosophy and ideas, and he is constantly putting them into practice. And not just into practice, but in a way that is activating, politicizing, and mobilizing people. In his native Croatia, he had a television program that tried to reintroduce intellectual life onto, you know, the public sphere, which was canceled supposedly because he had also written a very critical piece about Croatia's emergent anti-gay a referendum that was going on, and the rising tide of neo-fascism throughout the Balkans. So the plug was pulled on that show. He initiated a philosophy theater program to bring theater and philosophical thought closer together. He's one of the founders of the DM25 movement, which is trying to provide a meaningfully democratic alternative to the neoliberal EU government. And more than that, even, I would say, you know, he writes books. But I think, you know, most of the time, I think if you say, you should read this book, he's a great philosopher, a lot of people are like, I don't know, you know, a book of philosophy sounds a bit heavy to me. The great thing about reading Srećko's work, from his first, I think, major work, The Radicality of Love, which you should read, and I'll tell you why, not just because it's full of great ideas, but because it's written in a way that doesn't only cater to people who are already, you know, immersed in the world of philosophy. And I love that about, you know, other academics who are able to do that, who are able to sort of use their ideas and their thoughts meaningfully without getting stuck in, you know, highfalutin language and difficult concepts and sort of, you know, kind of showing off. He's after The Radicality of Love. I mean, he's written much more, but I definitely recommend his kind of recent book, Poetry from the Future, and his most recent book, After the Apocalypse, both of which, in different ways, are really about, you know, finding ourselves in a situation of almost overwhelmingly, you know, depressing crisis globally, and still finding ways, finding ideas, but also finding actual practices to help us move beyond that, to get to a better idea without, you know, being ignorant or being not cognizant of the actual problems that face us. When I first met Srećko in Amsterdam at the Brainwash Festival, I was completely smitten by him because, you know, he was so smart and he was so charming, and also he loved science fiction. And so, like, he uses a lot of, you know, elements, a lot of references to science fiction movies, as he does for tonight's lecture, which is called Do Lovers Dream of Electric Cars, which is, of course, a play on Philip K. Dick's famous novel, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, which was the basis for the movie Blade Runner. Well, no, that kind of, you know, playfulness and playful attitude is something that we try to incorporate not only into the talk, or that he incorporated into his keynote for tonight, but where we also tried to find a kind of a different way of doing this. So Srećko's not here. He's in Croatia right now, so he's going to beam in to us through the screen. But we're not going to, I'm sorry, if people were waiting for me to say, like, he's going to, here, and here he is, you know, put your hands together for Srećko. He's going to be up on the screen. But because we don't want to have an hour of just listening to a person up on the screen, because it's kind of boring, as a kind of lecture form. We worked together to create a series of short video essays that illustrate and kind of expand the ideas that he's developing in his talk. So where I would normally, after introducing, with, I think, rightful enthusiasm, a great speaker, I would normally end by saying, so now please join me in welcoming, Srećko, and he would come on stage, everybody would applaud. We're going to have a different thing, right? So I'll explain how this will go. I'm going to leave the stage in a moment, and then the lights will go down, and there will be the first of four short video essays that will start, right? And then after that, there'll be about three and a half minutes, and then Srećko will come on and say hello to all of you, and give part of his talk, and then there'll be another little video, and then halfway through the next part, at some point I'll come on and have a little exchange with him about what he's talking about. And then at the end, after four chapters, so you know how long you've got, four chapters, then I'll come back on stage and I'll moderate the Q&A. Okay? Does that make sense to everybody? Is that okay? So we can work with this. Sorry, I'm like Marie Kondo. I love mess. So that's why it's going to be messy but fun. Okay. So don't join me. Yeah. Well, no. Don't join me in welcoming Srećko, literally but metaphorically. And we're going to turn down the lights. And I will see you later.
I told you, you're wasting your time talking to her. However, you would not be wasting your time if you were dancing with her.
Vision of tomorrow's progressive luxury.
Everybody's been a McLaren in the world, and I will own one of them.
It's $1 million for a car. It's decadent.
Wow, I can't believe it's actually here. It's pretty wild, man. And now, obviously I've got $1 million car and quite a few creature comforts.
Stay at home. Make love.
It's just a moment in my life.
I'm making love until the morning. I'm gonna have myself some fun, 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 fun. Make love until the morning. In New York, in Detroit, hey, hey, hey. In New York, in Detroit, even in LA.
Good evening and hello. I'm extremely glad to be tonight with you. I mean, I'm not really that glad that I'm stuck in this egg where you cannot even see my my hands, but it kind of adds to tonight's topic and to the first chapter of my lecture, which is entitled Do Lovers Dream of Electric Sheep? And as Dan already said, it's of course a paraphrase of Philip K. Dick and his famous book, which later became perhaps an even more famous movie, Blade Runner. But before we start, I first want to thank the organizer to invite me. I also want to thank you in the audience for being patient and being here watching someone in an egg on the screen. And I also want to thank from the bottom of my heart to Dan, a dear friend and someone whose work on science fiction inspires me a lot. So also read his book, check out his work, and I'm really glad that we worked together on well, this hybrid lecture, as he said, which brings us immediately into today's topic and this first chapter on what I called the new libidinal economy. Namely, as you can see today, everything is becoming hybrid. Events are becoming pretty hybrid because of the pandemic. So now we are still in this kind of hybrid phase. Perhaps one day we will be in a kind of metaverse, whatever. But it also brings us to the title of the lecture, which is electric cars. Of course, today what we have mainly is still also in the same way we have hybrid events, we have hybrid cars, which are now moving to electric and so on. And what interests me today is actually the connection between today's prevailing ideology or today's prevailing libidinal economy and our innermost desires, emotions, libidinal economy, if you want to put it like that. So what is this new libidinal economy? What does the term libidinal economy mean in the first place? As some of you might know, it's a term which comes, of course, from French theory, from Lyotard, but also Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari, but also some other authors on the intersection between semiotics, Marxism, and psychoanalysis, who claim that besides just talking about the political economy, we should also talk about the libidinal economy. And they investigated in different ways, from different perspectives, the relationship between economy and desire, the relationship between capitalism and the unconscious. And when we speak about a new libidinal economy in the 21st century, I think what we are talking about actually is how the libidinal economy, namely the production or reproduction of desire, is connected to capitalism on the one hand and technology on the other hand. And also, as we will see today, how it is actually this new libidinal economy connected to the catastrophe itself, to the apocalypse, namely to the cataclysmic events which became our daily reality. So to start, you have seen a composition of various images. Some come from science fiction movies like Ex Machina, which you can see now on the screen, namely a movie about a Silicon Valley dude who has a search engine, sounds familiar, and decides to develop AI, artificial intelligence. I will not spoil the movie, but this movie also shows a prevailing ideology of Silicon Valley today, which is something what Evgeny Morozov calls technological solutionism. In the sense that technology will provide a solution for climate change, technology will provide a solution for the economy, and it will also provide a solution for love, for dating, for, you know, social interactions. And it is interesting that, you know, I have been preparing for this lecture, and it was quite fun, because it's interesting that what we have today, if you just look at the advertisements for cars, namely electric cars, you will get a sense of our new libidinal economy and also ideology. You know, if you want to have a glance at today's prevailing ideology, I suggest you to watch advertisements for electric cars, for online dating, and others. And basically what these ads for electric cars, and also COP26, which is a huge failure, as I assume most of you would agree, what we have today is this new ideology, which is the ideology of greenwashing, of course. Just take the commercials for electric cars, and you will see that they're basically not answering, I would say, four important questions. The first question is extraction. You know, if we all move to electric cars, are we going to end the vicious circle of extraction of resources, namely lithium? The second question is, of course, what are we going to do with all the waste, with the lithium batteries and so on? The third question is, of course, the most important question, the question of ownership. Why should everyone today in the world own a private car? And the fourth question, of course, last but not least, is the question, why cars in the first place? You know, this is presented as a big revolution, although you could have seen young Elon Musk, you know, 20 years ago dreaming about cars already. And it's not really a big revolution. It's actually going from fossil fuel powered cars to lithium powered cars. And what you can see at COP26 is precisely this ideological shift, where even capitalism itself, the corporations itself, are using the so-called Green New Deal or the Green Deal and ecology in order actually to sell more cars, to sell more dating apps, to sell actually everything what you are using today. This brings us into the next chapter, which is about COVID-19, love and politics.
ถ้าช่วงนี้คุณกำลังเหงาขอแนะนำให้คุณเปิด Tinder แล้วก็เหมือนเดิมสวัสดี Match Chat แล้วก็นัดกันไปมีเพื่อนสัมพันธ์ฮะเดี๋ยวเข้าใจผิดแล้วล่ะครับเพื่อนสัมพันธ์คืออะไรวะ
เพื่อนสัมพันธ์แปลว่าเพื่อนที่มีความสัมพันธ์กันแบบ
First you need toAsk yourself which protocols are non-negotiable. For example, mask wearing, physical distance, outside activities versus indoor date. And understand what type of date and contact level you want to have. It's all about evaluating risks and benefits.
J'aurais essayé de répondre à votre question sur Narcisse Eco. Évidemment, il se trouve que d'un point de vue plus directement lié à l'image que l'histoire de Narcisse et des causes, donc l'image aussi de c'est la question de l'image spéculaire et de la voix, le rapport entre la vue et la voix, entre donc la lumière et la parole, la réflexion miroir et puis la parole, ce qui se passe ici maintenant, n'est-ce pas, où il y a à la fois un miroir, une parole, une caméra, je réponds à des questions, je répète, donc je suis Narcisse et Écho là dans une scène tout seul, je fais Narcisse et Écho moi tout seul.
Ah, the holidays, the time to be with the ones you love, as they pass judgment on your love life. So, get ready. That question is coming.
Satan?
Hi. 2020?
Please, call me 2020. So where are you from?
Hell.
Me too.
Il y a ce qui arrive d'extraordinaire dans cette scène que j'ai étudié d'autre part dans des séminaires, dans des textes. Et ce que j'aime beaucoup dans cette scène, c'est le moment où Echo piège Narcisse en quelque sorte.
You may also want to consider both getting tested before meeting up, in case there will be some physical contact. Finally, take your time. This is a good opportunity to weed out all the bad prospects before deciding who you actually want to get involved with.
Et toujours, comme toute parole, un aveuglement. Quand on parle, parler, ça n'est pas voir. Hein? Donc toute parole, d'une certaine manière, est aveugle. Et au fond, Echo aveugle, aveuglément, mais très lucidement, correspond à Narcisse, et c'est une histoire d'amour évidemment, correspond à Narcisse qui lui-même s'aveugle, parce que quand Narcisse s'aperçoit, d'où la morgue, s'aperçoit qu'il ne peut voir que lui-même, que c'est son image qu'il voit dans l'eau, ne voir que soi-même, c'est une forme d'aveuglement.
Mais moi, quand j'ai mis l'os de l'yom, 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 แล้วคุณก็จะได้มีเพื่อนสัมพันธ์กับเพื่อนใหม่อีกเพียบ Tinder แอปหาเพื่อนสัมพันธ์
So what you could have seen is just a selection of dating apps with those pretty recent ones. As you can see, they were all in a way an effect to the COVID-19 crisis, which definitely changed, or I would say accelerated, the libidinal economy I'm talking about. For instance, I remember at, I think it was last Valentine's Day last year, when the authorities, the health authorities in San Francisco, made a list of prescriptions how you should date. And one of the suggestions was that once you have sex, you should have a face mask on. I think this is not just a funny example how ridiculous sometimes things can get, because very often, I think the exciting thing about sex, very often, if you're not in a relationship, is precisely the risk you're having. But what interests me here is how the COVID crisis accelerated a certain trend. I don't think it's necessarily new. I mean, in the last 20, 30 years since the invention of the internet, you could have seen that big tech is actually aiming at the privatization or monopolization of social interaction. So if they're after social interaction, for instance, the early Facebook, of course they will be soon also after our innermost desires. And if there is anything which is, what makes us human, then it's definitely love and falling in love. And when we're speaking about falling in love, of course, it's impossible to speak about it without mentioning the French semiotician and writer Roland Barthes, who in his, I think, still beautiful book about falling in love, not so much about love itself, The Lover's Discourse, actually convincingly shows that one of the crucial characteristics of falling in love is semiosis, is signification, which means it is the creation of signs. Interestingly enough, in English language, you still have this term, which is the significant other, which doesn't just mean the important other, but it could also mean an other to whom we are ascribing a certain meaning, you know, the other whose signs we are interpreting, and Barthes' book is precisely about that. What we have today as an effect of the COVID-19 crisis is that on the one hand, we have a flourishing of alienation, loneliness, different sorts of psychopathologies, narcissism, about which Jacques Derrida just talked about, in the sense that we cannot anymore see anything else but our own image. Just think of the never-ending zoomification of work, friendship, love, and so on. And on the other hand, besides this alienation, and it's a very ambiguous relation, I would say, what we have is an acceleration and commodification of love and desire. Eva Illouz, for instance, who was, I think, yesterday at your wonderful festival, calls it emotional capitalism. And she, instead of commodities, talks about emodities, you know, in the sense that our emotions have become commodities. And if you can see it anywhere so clearly, it is precisely the dating apps like Tinder, what you saw, which is now interestingly, I think precisely this ad which you show, not anymore just about sex, but it's about friends with other benefits. So you can see that Tinder is also going into this kind of direction where, you know, sex is not the most important one. But of course, they don't give up them, whether it's a friendship or it's sex. What they care about is the monetization of your relationships. And I think this is the biggest problem today. COVID-19 actually revealed how much privatization and monetization is going on. And it's not just anymore education, healthcare system, infrastructure. It is the general intellect which is being privatized. It is our emotions which are being privatized. And it's a problem because whatever you do on the internet, whatever you do in the dating apps, it's not just about data harvesting, but as we could have seen with Cambridge Analytica, with many other scandals, it is also about pre-programming and manipulation. And if they start pre-programming with whom you fall in love, you can know that we are in deep shit.
Okay. Okay, am I on?
Yes, I can see you in the egg. Welcome to my egg.
Okay, from one egg to another. Hi, Srećko. Let's see. I have to move. No, in the opposite direction. This is really weird. Okay, I'm here. I think I'm getting the hang of this. So sorry, we didn't have much opportunity to practice this except for with stills. I wanted to ask you just two questions. That's all the time we have. But one question that was bothering me, or that I've been thinking about ever since you first supplied some of the ideas for the video we watched before this chapter, was this idea of other benefits. And not other benefits as like just another way to commoditize, you know, our love life through a privately owned dating app. But the sense that I think for many of us on the left, there was also an idea that with the COVID pandemic, it was also a moment where we could rethink, you know, what our relationship was with work, what our relationship was with family, with you know, with our loved ones, how we even define those kinds of relationships and how we define our time. But then because the platforms that have regulated all of our communication are privately owned for-profit, you know, social media platforms, it feels like that potential for, you know, other benefits in a more radical way is evaporating. And I'm just curious to hear your thoughts on that, on whether this is something that we can still, you know, help to move forward, to move towards more progressive ideas, both about love, but also about politics and about labor. Or whether this is something that we're, again, always already too late for?
Yeah, great question. I think it brings us to this certain feeling of nostalgia, which I think many people have, which is weird in a way. Nostalgia towards the first lockdown, if you want to put it like that. You know, that beautiful fantasy that the dolphins got back to Venice, which was very soon revealed as fake news, of course, that the air pollution is gone and also all these things, and that after this we will finally realize what matters in life and so on. Well, that didn't happen on that scale. I think, of course, many people had various sorts of personal transformations, definitely. I think the kind of planetary awareness that we are not in the same boat, because some are like in the Titanic up there and some are down, but in the same ocean. And that I think people are realizing that. But the problem is that in the meantime, and COVID actually just accelerated this, I think the big tech, and it's not just Silicon Valley, but mainly it's a fight between Silicon Valley and China on the other hand, because European Union, as we know, is pretty impotent when it comes to technological innovation. I think the problem is that COVID served as a huge accelerator of all the trends which were already there in the internet. It didn't invent something new. But if you look, for instance, just take Croatia, where I stayed mainly, which is quite unusual for me, during the last 2 years. For instance, in Zagreb, in Split, 2 years ago, we didn't have yet, like you have in the, you know, very developed capitalism of the West, we didn't have Uber, we didn't have Deliveroo, Volt, all these delivery companies, you know, which are, of course, based on bullshit jobs and exploitation of poor workers, students, and so on. But during that pandemic, it accelerated. So basically now all the restaurants, you cannot call a restaurant and order food, but you have to go via platform capitalism. And I think the problem is that today, basically, whatever you do, whether it's renting a room in London or in Paris, you know, you go to Airbnb. Whether it is taking a drive, you take Uber. Whether it's, and that's what I'm claiming today, whether you fall in love, most of the people in a situation of a lockdown, in a situation of not so many public events, you know, a party where you meet people, a conference where you have a beer after it, or whatever you prefer, that's not happening anymore. And the dating apps are monopolizing one of the most important fields of human activity. So I think the situation is pretty dire, but in chapter four, we will try to speak a bit about a way out and about, you know, a kind of hope and how in this situation, which looks pretty bleak, and the next chapter is about the relationship between love and the apocalypse, how in this situation we can actually find a way out. I think that's the most interesting question, of course. But before we come there, I think it's interesting to analyze the situation. How it looks like.
Yeah. Okay. I do have another question, but now I'm going to save that for later.
You can do it now as well if you want. Let's be a bit spontaneous. If you want, we can do it now.
Okay, let's fuck it. Let's do it. Okay, we love mess. Okay. My other question is the problem, like being critical of these, so of big tech, you know, of social media platforms as corporations, and of the way in which the EU and also the United States government are, you know, partners in a lot of this work, is something that I think on the left we need to be extremely critical of, but we're not as good at mobilizing people and being critical of this as people on the far right. So I think we're seeing much more mobilization on the far right of people who are conspiracy theorists, who are, you know, trying to delegitimize institutions from universities to governments to healthcare to all of these things. So, you know, there was a big protest a couple of weeks ago in Amsterdam, and the weird thing was you saw people who were sort of on the left-wing fringes walking almost side by side with neo-Nazis. So I was curious, how do you think about the problems of, you know, relating to these huge, huge presences that are dictating our existence, and how we get to, you know, find ourselves with these strange bedfellows? And whether, you know, I mean, we don't want to collaborate with them, but how how do you see that tension?
Yeah, I think it's very interesting and also very scary in which way the positions between the left and the right kind of shifted. So usually it would be the left or the liberals which would advocate freedom of movement, freedom of speech, choice, you know, this par excellence idea of liberalism. But now actually you can see that it is the right, the conservatives, the alt-right and the conspiracists who are owning this fight for freedom of choice, freedom of movement, freedom of speech and so on, while the left and the liberals in most of the countries are advocating surveillance, more control, rules and authoritarianism. And I think this is a very peculiar situation where even people on the left or liberals have a difficulty to position themselves. And of course then you have what Gramsci would say, all sorts of morbid symptoms, which is both the left or the right protesting together in some situations, or this kind of blur between traditional positions between the left and the right. And you're absolutely right, I would agree with you, that it is the alt-right, or however you call it, fascism, you know, alt-right is just a beautiful name, posh name for postmodern fascism, if you want, that they are using technology in a much wiser way than the left, very often. When I say that, just think of the culture of memes, like in Bolsonaro's Brazil, for instance, or connected to Brexit, connected to Trump, how actually it is the alt-right which kind of owns the culture of memes. And I think memes are very important, similar like TikTok, because they work on a level of short attention span and unconscious in a way. And they are very subversive. I mean, it's beautiful art, memes. So I think you have this problem. And then, of course, let's not even start talking about NFTs or crypto, where you can see that, you know, an interesting, potentially emancipatory, progressive idea became owned by, you know, this kind of very masculine Silicon Valley energy, you know, the crypto fetishist, or where you have a situation where art itself also became in a way masculine and everything can become monetized. I mean, I don't think that the battle for crypto and NFTs is finished, but I'm just saying how as soon as a sort of new technology appears, crypto is not that new, of course, NFTs are much much newer, you can see capitalism already putting its hand on it and trying to monetize it. And that's what's happening now with NFTs. And it's really a good question how to get out of it. I mean, the question is, of course, whether we use it and we try to subvert it, or you get completely out of it, which I don't believe. I don't believe in this anarcho-primitivist dream that you can live on a tree and, well, whatever, you know, whatever happens in the world, you're safe. So, yes, I think we have a lot of things to do. We have to be very self-critical. Why are we in this situation? Because if you look at the technological innovations, for instance, it was the left as well, which, you know, Chile and the creation of their sort of internet during Allende, socialist Yugoslavia, where you had self-management, which was a very important concept in the sense of ownership, democracy at the workspace, and which kind of technology Yugoslavia was developing. Of course, there is nothing today anymore after the end of history. So there are some good examples in the past, but I think we have to create the future. I think that's our responsibility.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to try and see if I can crack out of this egg. And we're going to move ahead.
Good luck. I will be stuck in the egg.
Yeah, you're going to be stuck for a while. Okay, I'll see you later.
I just remembered, Pompeii was destroyed in 79 AD, by the way.
What was the volcano called?
Volcano.
Alexa, what volcano destroyed Pompeii?
Pompeii was destroyed by Mount Vesuvius.
Mount Vesuvius. For real?
the next stage after the commodification of desire, love, and falling in love is something what in my latest book, After the Apocalypse, which I think is going to be published in Dutch very soon, I think this year or next year, actually, in Dutch translation, it's what I call the commodification of the apocalypse, namely the commodification both of the revelation, which is the original meaning of the apocalypse, going back to ancient Greek apocalypses, but also the commodification of the catastrophe itself. So you almost have some sort of fetishism of the apocalypse, like it's enough to again look at Silicon Valley and their plans to escape Earth, whether to Mars or to nuclear shelters in New Zealand, but also our contemporary, of course, as always, popular culture. I mean, what you could have seen here are not so new products of popular culture. I mean, the most recent ones, of course, are, for instance, Foundation, The Dune, Squid Game, and so on, which are all pretty dystopian. These two, which we could have seen and which we can still see on the screen here, are one of my favorite science fiction movies. The first one, of course, is 28 Weeks Later. I also loved 28 Days Later. And this one, which you can see in the background, is, of course, Ruben Östlund's, the Swedish director's movie Tourist, or Force Majeure. And why did I choose these two movies, speaking about the relationship between the apocalypse and love, or falling in love, or being in love, or trying to preserve a love? I think the image which you can see now is the best possible introduction into this topic, namely what you can see here is, and I'm sorry if I'm spoiling it, but this is something which happened for those who didn't watch it, but this is something what happens at the very start of Force Majeure, namely you have a family, they're sitting on a table and there is an avalanche. And what happens during the avalanche is, I wouldn't say, it's not an apocalypsis on a major planetary scale, like climate crisis or the nuclear threat or the pandemic, which at the same time is a catastrophe and a revelation. This is, I would say, a smaller apocalypse, but nevertheless an apocalypse which has effects on the family itself. Because what happens in this scene is that the husband, the one in the blue jacket, escapes. So basically he leaves his wife and his two children and escapes. And that's the beginning of the movie. And I find it a brilliant movie. I love it even more than The Square by the same director, because it brings us to something very important, namely the meaning and importance of daily apocalypses, which doesn't have to be a catastrophic event, a war, or, you know, authoritarianism, or an asteroid or something, but it can be a very small event, like an avalanche, which didn't kill anyone, but it actually served as a sort of revelation. It showed what is wrong from the very start in this relationship. And it's a question whether the family can recover from it. The other movie, 28 Weeks Later, is also interesting because in the scene which you just shot, a very catastrophic but also apocalyptic event happens because the partner decides to leave his partner, well, just caring for his own selfish self, escaping the zombie apocalypse. And I think our current moment is unprecedented in a way, in the sense that we are facing a multiplicity of different catastrophes, from the climate crisis to the nuclear threat, or the collision between the climate crisis and the nuclear age. The best what you can see, best you can see it in the Pacific Islands, from Marshall Islands, Guam, and so on, which were victims of vast nuclear tests by the United States, and now are victims of the so-called progress development of the first world, namely climate crisis, which means rising sea levels and islands basically disappearing. So you also have a collision between the nuclear age and climate crisis. And then, of course, there is the pandemic. In this context, I think it is useful for us, and here we are slowly coming to a possible way out. I think in this situation it is useful to speak about the importance of love, solidarity, friendship, sex, desire. Because on the one hand, what you have is the commodification of desire, and on the other hand, it's the commodification of the apocalypse itself. Another good example comes from Tinder again. I don't know if you remember that, I think it was March 2020, that Tinder wanted to launch a new app, which was called Swipe Night, with the idea that an asteroid is hitting Earth, you are with your friends, you only have a few hours left, and you have to find your perfect match. Then, of course, the pandemic happened, and they thought, okay, who the fuck will now play this kind of apocalyptic game or app if our reality became even more realistic than this SF scenario. But then I think they launched it at the end of last year, and it also shows how the apocalypse, the catastrophe is interconnected with the libidinal economy. But before we start with the next chapter and the last one, and then I hope we can have a conversation, I just want to point out that I think that precisely the libidinal economy and everything what it contains, I mean, from desires, unconscious drives, dreams, if you want, do lovers dream of electric cars, I think this is the crucial field in which the future of humanity, which then also means the future of the planet, will be fought and resolved. Because if we are not able to control our desires, if we are not able to have relationships which are outside of the market, which are not commodified, then we are not left with anything anymore. So here comes the chapter 4.
I've seen things you people wouldn't believe. Attack ships on fire off the shoulder of Orion. I watched sea beams glitter in the dark near the Tannhauser Gate. All those moments will be lost in time, like tears in rain. Time to die.
Thank you.
Is it too late to exit what Mark Fisher would call capitalist realism? You know, this sense that it's easier to imagine, as Jameson would put, the end of the world than the end of capitalism. You know, this prevailing feeling that even if the world ends or if it radically changes as it is changing with the pandemic, we will still be left with capitalism. Is it too late to get out of the commodification of everything? Is it too late to get out of the commodification not only of, you know, food delivery, but also of dreams itself? And here we come, of course, to the answer to the, I would say, quite rhetorical question, whether lovers dream of electric cars. Unfortunately, yes. Unfortunately, the prevailing number of lovers, families, individuals are actually starting to dream about electric cars, because the dream about electric cars today is still much more pleasant than to realize that electric cars or the technological solutionism which is being sold to us today, than to realize that this will not get us out of the crisis. So what will get us out? So is there a way out? It's pretty late, but I think it's not too late yet. Of course, we are facing an unprecedented moment of acceleration of technology, of hyper-integration of different technologies, you know, from augmented reality to virtual reality, to this kind of narco-capitalism, in the sense that social technology works on the level of addiction, on the similar to, you know, if you take an ecstasy, you get a lot of serotonin or noradrenaline, or amphetamine, for instance, if you take, which gives you immediately, or not immediately, depends on the drug, a kick. And what's happening with social networks or with dating apps is precisely this. It's became an addiction. So the first way out, I think, is to realize that we all became addicted. And then the next step, of course, is to see how we can get out of this addiction. And I think here, discussing a way out, I think there are very useful tools from the past, even from past revolutionaries, but also past inventors who actually showed a way out. When we speak about revolutionaries, I will remind you that it was Che Guevara who said famously that a true revolutionary is led by a great feeling of love. Of course, he said on another place, on another time, that a true revolutionary is a killing machine. But this shows the ambiguity of revolutionary politics. On the other hand, someone who influenced me, and I think she is pretty relevant for our today's situation, is of course the great Soviet practitioner, revolutionary, but also writer, theorist, the first female ambassador, Alexandra Kollontai, namely her concept that in order to create more equal relations between people, and I'm now not just speaking about love relations, but also about different sorts of relations, we need to fight what she calls the privatization of heart, namely a sort of commodification which happens even without this very developed stage of capitalism, which happened, you know, before the October Revolution, a sort of commodification which people who fall in love tend to provoke. I mean, this is what Derrida is talking about when he speaks about narcissism, that we basically in the end fall in love with ourselves or with the image of ourselves, which is provided through the eyes of the other. And I think one of the steps is definitely one of the necessary steps in order to create a better society is definitely to realize that and to fight against it with all the powers we have, you know, in which way to open the space for the other, in which way to respect the other's desires, wishes, in a way in which the other person couldn't even fulfill itself. So definitely, I think we have to go back to this kind of understanding of free love, as Alexandra Kollontai would say, but also to concepts of solidarity, mutual aid, and last but not least, autonomy. I know that might sound pretty anarchistic, but well, there is, I think, pretty useful things in anarchism today. And when I speak about autonomy, I think about autonomy in the sense of not escaping capitalism. I think it's impossible to escape it. Not escaping technology. I'm not, you know, claiming that we should abandon all technology and live in a cave. But when I speak about autonomy, I think we should become aware of what this technology is doing to us, what it is doing on the level of emotions, on love, falling in love, friendship, how everything is being mediated, commodified. And I think there exists still, and there are useful examples today, maybe we can discuss it, of autonomy in which way you can actually create it in the existing parameters of the system. So, and last but not least, I think the progressive movements, especially the left, has to realize the importance and the power of emotions, of love, and of the unconscious. And well, this is where I will stop today. Dan will join me, and I hope you will also join me. I'm rushing through all these points. I'm happy to develop it further, but I'm rushing because we are tight with time, and I'm stuck in an egg. So Dan, please come back, and I'm looking forward to the questions.
Am I on? Yeah. I hope everybody enjoyed that as much as I did. I hope so. We're releasing Srećko from his egg and bringing him into this monolith over here, where we'll have him on stage for technical reasons, and also because being stuck in an egg for an hour is not something you would inflict on anybody willingly. But I think it worked for the design. So I think any moment we'll have Srećko here. And we have a bouncy throw microphone that we will toss at you. There we go. For anybody who has a question, there's Srećko. Srećko, you're no longer
egg-shaped. That feels so much better. I know that from your perspective, you all think that everything is the same when you're behind the screen, but it's much better to be out of the egg.
Yeah, I was only in it for about 10 minutes, but it felt very claustrophobic.
Yeah.
Okay, so anybody with a raise your hand and we'll throw a microphone at you. Or we'll just keep talking, which is another option, but there's a question.
Great.
Is it on? Dan, is it on?
Yep.
Yeah, it's on.
Hi, Srećko. This is Arjon. Thanks for your wonderful talk. I would like to ask a question on this commodification of the apocalypse. I mean, I get the concept of how fear can be politicized or can be used as a political tool. From what you said, I understand it's not the same as this commodification of the apocalypse. But please, maybe can you expand on this term, on this idea?
Yeah, sure. I think. Again, it's not necessarily something new. I mean, I was investigating the apocalypse and the different relationships towards the apocalypse for my latest book. And if you go back, for instance, I think one of the best examples of what I call the commodification of the apocalypse is post-apocalyptic tourism. And it's also not something new. You know, if you go back to Pompeii was the first place where this kind of post-apocalyptic tourism started to happen. Of course, first for the bourgeoisie, the rich travelers from England and other places who were going there and walking around this frozen city. But fast forward, I, for instance, just before the pandemic, went on a tourist trip. I wanted a tourist trip, not to go with the stalkers and so on, but precisely to experience what this tourism and commodification of apocalypse means. I went to Chernobyl, to Pripyat 2 years ago, and it was quite an experience. Why do I say it was quite an experience? Because it was very difficult to escape the commodification of the apocalypse and the mediation of the apocalypse. So let me just give you a kind of insight how it looked like. At that stage, you know, that was just after the HBO series Chernobyl became so famous. Basically, in Kiev, you could find these Chernobyl buses tours on every corner. Once you go there, You can buy, you know, once you come to the so-called exclusion zone, because it's not just Chernobyl. Chernobyl is just a small part where the reactors are based, but also Pripyat, this city which had 50,000 inhabitants. And as soon as you come to the kind of roadblocks before you enter the exclusion zone, you can buy souvenirs. You can buy souvenirs, for instance, a T-shirt, enjoy Chernobyl, die later. You can buy packed air of Chernobyl, and basically everything, even this experience, is being commodified. And once you enter the exclusion zone, this is the experience I had in Pripyat, the guide, young Ukrainian woman, was showing us pictures, and on the pictures what you saw were the images from the HBO series. And you know, for someone who comes from Croatia, this was very interesting, because I had a kind of déjà vu, and my déjà vu was I saw something very similar in Dubrovnik, you know, this city which, like Venice, doesn't exist anymore. No one is living in the city anymore. I mean, in Venice it's around 50,000 people. Now they are doing all this surveillance system there. In Dubrovnik it's much less. So basically the old city doesn't live. It lives only during tourist season, and instead of tourists coming there to research or see the very interesting legacy of how Dubrovnik, when it was an independent republic, dealt with the plague. You know, Dubrovnik was the first city which invented the maritime quarantine before Venice in Italian cities. They come there and they watch, just as I did in Chernobyl, images of Game of Thrones. And I think this is one of the problems. There are many others of the commodification. Not just the apocalypse, but of everything. But in the case of the commodification of the apocalypse, we'll just think about Chernobyl. I think the problem is that you have a certain mediation. So, of course, you always have a mediation, but here the mediation comes directly from Hollywood or popular culture. So you cannot even see anymore Pripyat. Of course, you cannot see radioactivity. You have a Geiger constantly, so you can at least hear it or sense it. But actually, everything is mediated through a fictional, through television, in a way. Same as Game of Thrones. And I think the biggest problem of the commodification of the apocalypse is a sort of anesthetization. You know, that you become accustomed to the catastrophe. You know, there is this term, which is pretty recent, doom scrolling, you know, but I guess Dan does a lot, I do as well, you know, before you go to sleep. You're an idiot again, and scroll all this bad news, and then you have nightmares, and everyone does it. You know, there is a certain fascination with the catastrophe, even after the pandemic, you know, that's amazing. I don't know whether you saw that last weekend when there was this All Saints holiday, a bunch of people went to La Palma, to the Canary Islands. Why did they go there? They wanted to see the La Palma volcano, which is erupting for the last 2 months. So, I mean, this is another example of post-apocalyptic tourism. So there is something fascinating in catastrophic events. I mean, everyone who loves science fiction knows that. But there is also this commodification that, instead of taking it seriously, instead of using the revelation to change, to change our lives radically, we are commodifying it. You know, we are taking pictures, putting it on Instagram and waiting for likes. Entrapped in the same kind of technological machine of late capitalism.
Can the microphone go over there? Yeah.
Thank you, Srećko. I would like to ask you to expand on what you said last, and you only kind of scratched on it, and you, in one line, you said, you mentioned solidarity, mutual aid, and autonomy. So how can I understand that relationship, and what do you exactly mean with autonomy in terms of the use of technology or decentralization or autonomous media and tech use? Please tell us a bit more about your thoughts there.
Yeah, of course. This is a concept which is, of course, connected to anarchism, and most famously to the Italian movement of autonomia, of autonomy, to a great contemporary philosopher, Franco Berardi Bifo, who is also writing about it. You know, how in this atmosphere in which basically all our activities are not just mediated, but in a way also programmed or pre-programmed, or we are forced to use the existing technology, like Zoom, for instance. You know, if you want to have a job, if you want to fall in love, you have to use platform capitalism. And in this context, I think the concept of autonomy becomes crucial. What does it mean? Yes, you mentioned the autonomy of media. Well, seeing what's happening to Julian Assange and to others who were fighting for this kind of independence of publishing, I don't think that we can really talk about any media today being really independent or autonomous. Speaking about social movements or festivals or art, I think it's also very difficult to say that anything is autonomous anymore. Festivals have sponsors. Art is also kind of entrapped in this world now with NFTs, for instance, but also duty-free art, as Hito Sterov would say. So I think what we have to do is, on the one hand, to get rid of this, I think, naive idea that it's possible to get out. You know, I have friends who say, oh, crypto is bad. I'm also not a big fan of it. Also, I'm trying to find out much as I can, but at the same time they will use a Macintosh computer, you know. So I think we should get rid of this kind of guilt feeling or moralizing, you know, oh, you are worse because you are using Mac, or you are worse because you are using crypto, which is ruining our planet, and so on. I think the situation is so ambiguous and contradictory that actually this kind of moralization doesn't make sense, but at the same time we have to try to create autonomous spaces. What does that mean? It means that, you know, 10 years ago, for instance, you had all this reawakening energy around the world, from Tahrir to Syntagma Square, to Podemos, to the Indignados in Spain. And what you had later, of course, was Podemos, was Syriza. In Egypt, it's much worse because you had the Muslim Brotherhood and you basically have a Western-sponsored dictatorship with 60,000 people in prison, 60,000 people in prison in Egypt who were connected to one way or the other to Tahrir and the Arab Spring. And after this huge enthusiasm, it was kind of transferred either on the Messiah, whether the Messiah was Pablo Iglesias or Alexis Tsipras or Bernie Sanders, you know, this figure of the leader which we are kind of, like in psychoanalysis, you have a transfer towards that person, or even fall in love in that person. Usually it's a male person, as we know, because we live in patriarchy. In a way, you transfer your hopes, your desires, and when they disappoint you, you fall into something what Walter Benjamin calls left-wing melancholia. I think one way out is not to disband on completely the field of representative democracy or building political parties or trying to, you know, have this long march through the institutions and trying to change as much as you can. But I think, you know, we have to do that, of course. Some people are better, some are much worse. Most of them are pretty bad when it comes to this kind of politics. But I think at the same time, we have to create parallel spaces or something what Michel Foucault would call heterotopia, which is not a utopia, it's not a dystopia, it's a coexisting space. A coexisting space which exists inside of capitalism, but is trying to create let's say a world after capitalism, post-capitalism. So don't wait for the Messiah. Try to build it today. What you are preaching, that would be my point. And if you ask me concretely, what does that mean? I think it definitely means getting rid of the addiction of technology. Trying to, you know, I'm not preaching now a naive return to nature, but it definitely means more off-screen time in order to rebuild a kind of social autonomy which still exists. But at the same time, I think it is crucial that people who understand technology much better than me actually see in which way new technologies can serve a sort of autonomy. Like an example, for instance, recent one, I'll give you two and then I shut up, is one is Edward Snowden. You know, when NFTs appeared, he was the one who made his first NFT and donated all the money which was earned through the NFT to the Freedom of Press Foundation. It was more than $4 million, I think 4.5. So where you have an example of what I call subversion, in which way you can use new technology for a good cause, for a foundation which fights for media freedom and freedom of speech and the independence of media and for the rights of whistleblowers. A much recent example is MIA, my dear friend and a great revolutionary pop icon, I would say, who recently released a few NFTs, and all the money will go to Courage Foundation, which is now mainly fighting for the freedom of Julian Assange. So here you have an example. Of course, we can debate it whether that's a subversion or not, but you have a sort of subversion, I would say, where you are using contemporary technology in order to create autonomous or semi-autonomous spaces in which the foundation who gets the money, for instance, can decide what to do with this money. That's just one small example. Of course, this is not a solution for our planetary crisis. I see Dan is smiling, but I shut up.
I'm smiling because basically, I think as you can tell, ask Srećko a small question and you get basically what for any other person would be a full keynote. I feel like I've had like a sequence of at least five brilliant keynotes, one after the other tonight. It was a true privilege to be here. I wish we could spend more time in this room with you.
That's it. We are at the end.
Exactly. There's a question over there. Can we? They're saying like my stage manager. I'm want to say yes, but like everybody here is like don't. Like the stage manager here, like 5 minutes ago, there was the time's up sign, and then she started flashing the time's really up sign, and now she's flashing the get the fuck off the stage, dude sign. So
kill the stage manager and stay there. Occupy the room.
No. I'm gonna. So we've been listening to Srećko and looking at him. He can't see you, so I'm gonna take a picture. Just so. There you go. If everybody can be suitably enthusiastic for just a moment. There, I'll
Thanks
send
a
it.
Lot.
I'll send it to him, and here.
I must say this was one of the most fun events. Actually, these online events, people get pretty tired of it. I hope you in the audience also enjoyed it. At least you can have a beer now. I can't. But okay, the stage manager will kill me now. But
okay, so she can't. But she'll kill me because I'm here in the physical state. So I'm going to get my ass off of here. I want to thank you so much, Srećko. You can't see them, but I'll send you a picture. But please let yourself be heard and join me in thanking Srećko Horvat.
Thank you. Bye. Have a nice evening. And make love.